first concept presented to us is that we should give thanks because God is a redeemer. Let's look at Psalm 107, verses 1 and 2. From the New International Version of the Bible, the Word of God reads, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe." There was a little boy named Tom, and Tom went out carrying his brand new boat to the edge of the river. And he carefully placed the boat in the water, and he slowly let the stream go because the boat was tied to the stream. And the boat began to move downstream a bit. Tom ran along the shore, and he just kind of enjoyed his day in the warm sunshine with his boat that he had built himself. Suddenly, a strong current came and caught the boat, and they tried to bring it back to the shore, but the boat was snatched away, and the stream broke, and it went downstream. He ran to try to catch up with the boat, and after a while, the boat disappeared. He looked all day for the boat, all day until it became too dark to look any longer, and he sadly went home. A few days later, on the way home from school, Tom spotted the boat, just like his, in a store window. When he got closer, he could see, sure enough, that was his boat. He hurried inside to the store manager and said, "Sir, that's my boat in the window. I made that." "Sorry, son, but someone else brought it in this morning. If you want it, you'll have to buy it for $1. Tom ran home and counted all of his money. All he had was $1. When he reached the store, he rushed to the counter. "Here's the money for my boat." And as he left the store, Tom hugged his boat and said, "Now you're twice mine. First I made you, and now I bought you." As believers in Jesus Christ, all of us have a story to tell about a God who loved us enough to make us, but then saw our despairing condition and had an even greater amount of love to pay the price to buy us from a life of sin. And for that, we should give thanks. Give thanks to God for his redemption. Let's look at verses 8 and 9, and we're going to find here that we should give thanks because God satisfies. The verses read, "Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind, for he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things." You know, I'll tell you, Thanksgiving has not always been one of my favorite holidays. There are a lot of Recently, Thanksgiving has become a lot better. Because for me, the traditional Thanksgiving meal just doesn't satisfy. And if some of you are thinking and you've already planned ahead, you know that you've got grandma's sweet potato pie waiting on you, and you're excited about eating these foods that you probably eat once a year. You know, you start thinking about things like turkey and dressing, greens, cranberry sauce, rolls, ham and chicken. I know I'm messing you up right now because you can feel your stomach chewing on your own ribs, but I gotta go through this. Potato salad and cornbread and macaroni and cheese and green beans. But I'll eat that stuff year after year, and somehow it just didn't satisfy. So a couple of years ago, my lovely wife asked me what I would like for Thanksgiving. And I told her I wanted my favorite foods. Because there's nothing that fills my boat like barbecue ribs. So I wanted ribs for Thanksgiving. And she asked me, "What about sweet potato pie?" I'm not a pie person, I'm from a cake family. So I wanted an Italian cream cake. That's my favorite cake. So we had barbecue ribs and Italian cream cake and whatever. Serve a God who a steady diet of hot dogs and a steady diet of whatever they offer free on campus. I said, I made my schedule to go get anything that was free on campus. I don't care if it was free popcorn. I was having popcorn that night for dinner because I had to eat, but I serve a God who has set me free from those social economic restraints. Some of which are struggling with the barrier of low self-esteem and maybe a poor self-image. There are also barriers in your attitude, and the Lord's going to need you, listen now, the Lord's going to need you to be free from your attitudes, and He's going to need you to be free from certain behaviors if you're going to be functional and productive out in the world. When I was in college, I thought I knew it all. I thought I had it all together. I wasn't conceited. I was convinced. And I will tell people that. But when I entered the real world, God showed me how bound I really was. You see, I was cruel and I was manipulative and I was self-centered. I was impulsive and impatient and a few other things that I cannot mention in this setting. But these dispositions hindered my growth. They hindered my progress and my advancement in work and in relationships. But the Lord changed all of that. He set me free from those barriers and the bars that surrounded me. And now, whenever people compliment me for being a kind and a patient person, a giving person, I have a story to tell. I have thanks to give to God because I know I wasn't always that way. And I want to tell you that if you're suffering from bondage to habits and behaviors like substance abuse or immorality, impulsive behavior, difficulty in delayed gratification, sensation seeking, or antisocial personality, nonconformist values, and sense of alienation, deviant behavior, heightened feelings of stress, little regard for goals generally valued by society, I want to tell you, there is a God who can set you free so that you too can give thanks. Next, we find that our God is wonderful and we should give thanks because God is working. Look at verses 21 and 22. Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and His wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them sacrifice thank offerings and tell of His works with songs of joy. The psalmist says we should tell of the Lord's works. And this should be something to encourage us to realize God is working in our lives. Even when we don't see Him, God is at work. Even when we don't really understand what's going on and we just enjoy the benefits, always remember that in the background, God is at work. If you could pull back the fabric of reality and look behind the scenes, you would see a God who never slumbers nor sleeps. You will see a God that's always looking out for your best interest. You will see a God who is making miraculous things appear in your life from day to day. I remember as a child going to theme parks, particularly Six Flags. I would go to Six Flags there in Georgia, and I would always want to be a part of that group that wants to be there as soon as the park opened. You know, so the park opened at 10, I'm there at 9. And when you walk inside, the ground was always wet. Even though it may have been, you know, 90 degrees outside, the ground was wet. But I also looked, not only was the ground wet, but there was no trash. Well, what happened was I actually ended up working for Six Flags in Jordan, in Dallas, Texas. And as I worked at Six Flags over Texas, they explained to me why the ground was wet and why there was no trash. Because there were some people you never saw. Every time the park closed at night, an army of people would move in. They would hose down the entire park, sweeping all the trash away, hosing down all the rides, making sure that everything is nice and clean. They would work all night long until the morning crew came in to get the park ready for guests. They were behind the scenes. They were never seen by the general public. We may not always know that God is working. But you need to be sure that God is at work. Even when you are sleeping, God is at work. He's working in your past, bringing us, He worked in your past already to bring you to where you are today. He's working in your present, guiding you towards your future, and He's working in your future, clearing the path for your destiny. We serve a God who works for that. that we should give thanks. Lastly, I want to tell you that we should give thanks because God has given us a legacy. Look at verses 31 and 32. It says, let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them exalt him in the assembly of the people and praise him in the council of the elders. I am a member of Generation X. Growing up, I constantly heard that we were the lost generation. You ever wonder why the generation didn't start with A? It's because of us. My generation was the one they said we were going to just destroy the entire world. So they just gave us an X because they didn't know what we were going to be like. We were so different from previous generations. We were the latchkey kids. We were that generation that first had both parents outside of the home. And we came home from school by ourselves with a key and let ourselves in. We were the generation that had the high numbers of teen pregnancy. That, you know, now they're talking about the teen pregnancy rates going down. They're just saying that we're not teenagers anymore because it was our generation that was the one that was the heightened levels of teen pregnancy. We also had increased drug abuse and peer pressure, negative peer pressure, heightened gang activity. You know, it was my generation. We were watching movies about gangs when we were kids because the gangs were spreading from L.A. and Chicago all over the country. So we grew up being introduced to Bloods and Crips and all these other gangs and we were out there. So we were named Generation X. If you're a student here at Tuskegee University, you're not in Generation X. You're a millennial. And millennials are characterized as being optimistic and idealistic and patriotic and also over-parenting. Think about the goodness of God, his loving kindness, his tender mercies. Think about legacy he will leave.